Welcome back to Launchpad. I'm Christian Reddy, your friendly neighborhood astronomer. In our last video on ESA's solar orbiter, we talked briefly about how it compares to the Parker Solar Probe. But come to think of it, it's been a while since we last checked in on Parker. It turns out it's been busy. Now, for a quick recap, Parker was launched in August 2018 to investigate the sun's outer atmosphere, or corona. And there's two really weird things about the corona. First, it's millions of degrees hotter than the sun's surface, despite being well above the sun's surface. Even though its temperature was determined in 1940, no explanation for the coronal heating problem has ever been tested experimentally. Another problem is that the solar wind is accelerated in the corona to millions of miles per hour. But it's not clear how the wind is accelerated either. In order to understand both of these phenomena, you need to trace the flow of energy and make measurements in the region where the action happens. But that requires being there, in the sun's corona, which is really, really hot. That's why Parker is protected by a heat shield made of carbon composite, along with solar arrays that are cooled by water and retract as Parker swings around the sun. During its closest approach, Parker will fly to within 9 solar radii of the sun's surface. That's about 3.83 million miles, or just 0.05 astronomical units. At that distance, the heat shield will reach temperatures near 2,500 degrees Fahrenheit, but the spacecraft's payload will be at room temperature at about 85 degrees. However, it's going to be a while before Parker makes its closest approach because it has to get rid of some of the orbital energy it inherited from Earth. So Parker was launched into an elliptical orbit around the sun, and its launch was timed in such a way as to make the occasional flyby of Venus. During each of these flybys, some of Parker's orbital energy is transferred to Venus, and the spacecraft descends closer with each orbit. As it approaches the sun, Parker samples the solar wind, while other spacecraft like Stereo A and B, SDO and SOHO, see the overall environment Parker flies through. This allows the science team to put Parker's observations in their proper context and understand what the sun was doing when the measurements were made. Now, even though it won't make its first really close approach until 2025, Parker's already come much closer than any spacecraft in history. And Parker's already made some really interesting discoveries about the sun. So, here now are 5 really cool things Parker learned about the sun, plus something else it learned that's really cool that's not about the sun at the end. Number 1, evidence for a dust-free zone. The sun is surrounded by a thin disk of dust spread throughout the inner solar system. Some of it comes from comets, while some are the remains of collisions that formed the planets, asteroids, and comets billions of years ago. This dust scatters sunlight. If you can get to a dark enough site on a clear night, you'll see the faint glow of this dust in a phenomenon called zodiacal light. It's long been thought that close to the sun, the radiation there should be high enough to either vaporize the dust particles entirely or push them away with radiation pressure. But from our vantage point on Earth, we cannot discern the disk's interior edge. But as it made its way around the sun during its first 3 orbits, it noticed a thinning out of the dust starting at about 7 million miles from the sun. This decrease in dust continued steadily to the limits of WISPR's measurements, which at the time could see to a little over 4 million miles from the sun. At the current rate of thinning, it's possible that the truly dust-free zone may start around 2 to 3 million miles from the sun's surface. That means Parker may see this dust-free zone as early as September 2020 when it makes its 6th flyby of the sun and closes to within 11.5 million miles. But if that weren't cool enough, Parker also heard the dust striking the spacecraft as it passed through it at 250,000 miles per hour. At that speed, the spacecraft doesn't just crash into these particles, it obliterates them into a plasma that Parker's plasma fields instrument can, for lack of a better word, here. Pretty cool, huh? However, each collision chips away a tiny bit of the spacecraft. And this was something that the Parker team expected to happen, but until now, they could only guess at the rate of these collisions using models based on remote observations. It turns out the dust is more dense than expected, but not enough to pose a concern for the mission. Still, it's just one of those things you can't tell for sure until you're there. Not only did Parker hear the dust impact the spacecraft, but number two, Parker hears the turbulence of the solar wind. The solar wind is the stream of charged particles, or plasma, blowing from the corona in all directions. But weirdly, the solar wind actually speeds up as it leaves the sun. Not only that, but it stays hot, even as it travels away from the sun. By the time the wind reaches Earth, it is largely flowing at a steady rate. Any trace of the mechanism that heated and accelerated the wind has been smoothed out. But closer to the sun, Parker's field's instrument revealed a much more chaotic and turbulent system even when the sun is quiet. Fields detected thousands of waves of plasma rippling through the solar wind. Such waves would be driven by fluctuations in the electric and magnetic fields. It's kind of like how fluctuations in pressure on Earth create the winds that drive rolling waves on the ocean. In the solar wind, particles can ride these plasma waves and are propelled to higher speeds. But as they surf those waves, the particles interact with each other, creating fluctuations in the frequency and amplitude of those waves. Parker recorded these waves as they passed by, and they sound really cool. These are Whistler mode waves. They're caused by energetic electrons bursting out of the sun's corona. These electrons follow magnetic field lines that stretch from the sun out to the solar system's farthest regions. But as they do so, the electrons spiral around the lines. When a plasma wave's frequency matches the frequency of the spinning electrons, they amplify each other. It's thought that part of the solar wind's acceleration may be due to these escaping electrons. It's also possible that they may play a role in heating the solar wind. As the plasma waves move through the solar wind, they quickly shift from one frequency to another, creating other waves called dispersive waves that fields detect. These dispersive waves are rarely detected near Earth, so they weren't thought to be a significant driver of the solar wind. But near the sun, dispersive waves are everywhere. It's not yet clear what causes the changes in frequencies that creates these waves, or how they may heat the solar wind. But this is a really cool finding that's going to be followed up on with future orbits. And speaking of funky electromagnetic phenomena, Parker also discovered number three, magnetic switchbacks. During its first couple of orbits, Parker's fields instrument detected sudden reversals in the magnetic fields. At first, it was thought that the spacecraft might have been passing through a series of magnetic field lines with alternating polarities. But the solar wind electrons, alphas, and protons, or sweep experiment, made measurements of the particles flowing along the magnetic field lines. Sweep showed that the outflowing wind particles were, in fact, reversing their direction, and then reversing again to their original outflow with twice the kinetic energy of the background wind. The science team dubbed these reversals switchbacks. Nothing like them have ever been detected before. At Earth's distance, only the occasional wiggle of some magnetic field lines have ever been detected. But these are full 180-degree reversals that pack a ton of energy. It's like trying to do the same thing with a bungee cord that's already pulled taut. The more tightly drawn it is, the more energy is required to reverse it. These switchback reversals last anywhere from a few seconds to several minutes. When the field reverses, it's like cracking a whip, and the particles pack twice the kinetic energy. Parker measured clusters of switchbacks during its first two flybys. But as it flew closer to the sun on subsequent orbits, it measured an increase in both the number and the energy of the switchbacks. The exact source of the switchbacks isn't yet understood, but with each new set of measurements, scientists can narrow down the possibilities. It's thought that as Parker gets closer to the sun, the switchbacks should become more common and stronger. If that turns out to be the case, they may turn out to be one of the energy sources that's heating the corona. And Parker doesn't have a camera that faces the sun because the radiation it faces would fry any camera we could put on it. But ESA's solar orbiter may be able to image new features on the sun that can be linked to these switchbacks. Solar Orbiter already spotted small bursts of energy dubbed campfires. As Solar Orbiter gets closer to the sun, it'll determine whether or not these campfires are the long-theorized nanoflares, and if so, are they providing the energy needed to generate the switchbacks that accelerate the solar wind? But the atmosphere and solar wind behave differently than we thought in a very significant way. In particular, number four, the atmosphere and solar wind rotate farther from the sun than we thought. The solar wind emerges from the corona. Near Earth, the wind streams more or less radially from the sun, going out in all directions. But the sun rotates, carrying the corona with it. That means the solar wind is initially traveling in a curved path before switching to a straight one. It's a little bit like riding a merry-go-round. The farther you are from the center, the faster you're moving. If you jump off, you would be moving in a straight line outward. Somewhere between the sun and Earth, the solar wind does the same thing and transitions from a rotational to a radial flow. Exactly where this happens has implications for how the sun and how stars in general slow down over time. Parker's sweep instrument measured this rotational flow for the first time when it was still 20 million miles from the sun. That's considerably farther from the sun than predicted. Not only that, but as Parker approached perihelion, the speed of the rotation increased to more than 10 times faster than predicted. Not only does this tell us something about our star, but it has implications for understanding the life cycles of stars in general and the formation and even habitability of their planetary systems. You see, where and how the wind transitions affects how rapidly the star slows its rotation. The farther away the wind transitions, the more rotational energy it carries away, and the more quickly the star slows down. In general, the slower a star rotates, the less magnetically active it is, and the more habitable its planets are. Perhaps one of the reasons we're here in the first place is because the sun slowed its rotation quickly enough to give life a chance to evolve into complex, sophisticated creatures. Of course, that doesn't mean the sun is completely without activity. Even during the quiet times, Parker observed, number five, small flares and space weather. We know that electrons and ions in the solar wind are accelerated by explosive solar activity. Exactly how this happens is not yet well understood, but under the right conditions, it can create storms of energetic particles. Major events on the sun, such as flares and coronal mass ejections, can send these particles racing out into the solar system at nearly the speed of light. That means they can reach Earth in under half an hour. These particles carry a lot of energy, enough to damage spacecraft, electronics, and endanger astronauts. When astronauts eventually do return to the moon and head out for Mars, they won't have the protection of Earth's magnetic field, and they won't have much advance warning either. However, Parker's Integrated Science Investigation of the Sun, or ISIS, there I said it, I'm taking it back, detected several high-energy particle events that have never been seen before. These events preceded a small coronal mass ejection that unleashed a burst of material with as much mass as Lake Michigan. ISIS detected high-energy particles rushing ahead of the ejected mass. If we can learn more about the nature of these phenomena, it may be possible to use them as part of an early warning system for future explosions. Meanwhile, the CME ejecta formed structures in the corona and solar wind that were captured by the Wide Field Imager for Solar Probe, or WISPER. High-energy particles slammed into WISPER's cameras, creating these brief flashes of radiation called snow as they bombarded the detectors. Previously, radiation snow had only been detected by spacecraft like the Solar Heliospheric Observatory, or SOHO, during major solar eruption events. But now WISPER is detecting them on a much smaller scale inside the corona, while ISIS is detecting the kinds of high-energy particle events that may be causing them. All of these observations demonstrate just how active the sun is, even during the so-called quiet times. But Parker, and its sideways-facing WISPER camera in particular, are in a position to see some really cool things in our solar system that aren't the sun, which brings me to number six, cool things Parker detected in our solar system that aren't the sun. During Parker's first solar encounter in November 2018, its Whisper camera picked up a really faint structure that's never been seen before, a 60,000-mile-wide dust trail in the orbit of the asteroid Phaethon. Phaethon is one of the closest sun-approaching asteroids in our solar system. Its orbit is highly elliptical and reaches all the way out past Mars's orbit. A couple of thousand years ago, Phaethon approached the sun and something happened to it. We're not sure what happened to it, but it released a long debris trail into its orbit. Every December, Earth passes through this debris field and we see them as the Geminid meteor shower. Phaethon comes about as close to the sun as Parker does. Every time it does so, it heats up and bits of the crust break off to form a dust trail. It's like Phaethon is a kind of rock comet. So was this particular trail of dust created in the same event that created the Geminid meteor shower thousands of years ago, or was it created more recently? To find out, scientists estimated the mass of the dust in the Parker images. They found that the trail weighs about 1 million tons. However, Phaethon is currently losing mass at a rate that is way too low to create the amount of dust in this trail. However, the amount of dust measured is comparable to the estimated amount of dust that hits our atmosphere every December during the Geminids. And that's pretty solid evidence that Parker is looking at dust created in the same event that created the Geminids. In other words, Parker saw what a meteor shower looks like from space, only one that's caused by an asteroid instead of a comet. And speaking of comets, Parker got a really nice look at the newly discovered comet NEOWISE on July 5th. On the right side of the image, there's sunlight being scattered by dust. In fact, there's a little black structure on the lower left of the image that's actually a grain of dust resting on the camera lens. The comet's broad dust tail is easily visible here, but after some processing to remove the excess brightness from scattered sunlight, the comet's straight ion tail pointing directly away from the sun can be seen. So yeah, Parker's been busy, and now it's been joined by ESA's solar orbiter, which orbits a little farther away. But unlike Parker, it will get just close enough to take the closest images of the sun. In fact, ESA just released their first set of images from solar orbiter, and I made a video about them and the solar orbiter mission. So if you haven't seen that one yet, I'll meet you over there when we're done here. My thanks as always to my Patreon supporters for helping to keep Launchpad Astronomy going. And I'd like to welcome my newest patrons, Johan Gergen, Kelly T. Fitzhugh, Ethan Liu, and Andrew Ward. I'd also like to thank Anna for her intergalactic level support, and Michael Dowling and Stephen J. Morgan for their cosmological level support. If you'd like to help Launchpad for the price of a cup of coffee every month, please head on over to my Patreon page. And if you'd like to join me on this journey through this incredible universe of ours, well, please make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell so that you don't miss out on any new videos. Until next time, stay home, stay healthy, and stay curious, my friends.